The thoracic cage is an osseocartilaginous frame around your principal organs of respiration and circulation. And it's gonna be very narrow above, as you can see here in this area above. And it's gonna be very broad on the area below. It's also gonna be flattened in the anterior-posterior direction. And the posterior wall, as you can notice, is gonna be longer than the anterior wall. Now, as for the composition of the walls, if you notice the posterior wall, you're gonna have the thoracic vertebrae with the intervertebral discs and posterior parts of the ribs. And then in the anterior wall, you're gonna have the sternum with the costal cartilages. For example, those that you can see right there. And in the lateral walls, such as this one, the right and left, you're gonna see the ribs and the costal cartilages separated by intercostal spaces. And it's also gonna contain intercostal muscles and membranes, blood vessels, nerves, lymph vessels, and lymph nodes. Now, on the thorax, we're going to have an area that we call the superior thoracic aperture or the thoracic inlet, which is also the name of the thoracic outlet by clinicians. So that is this area right here. I'm going to attempt to draw it real quickly. So that is this right here, as you can see. And this area transmits the esophagus, the trachea, for example, numerous vessels and nerves between the thorax on one side and the neck and upper limbs on the other side. It's plain, it slopes anteriorly and inferiorly, and its boundaries is going to be the body of T1. Let me try and attempt to move this. Be the body of T1. Whoops, the drawing is still there, but you can see that it's T1 right there. The anteriorly, now you're gonna have the superior border of the manubrium, as you can see right there. I'll try and put it again where it was. So that is your manubrium right there. Right. And then you're gonna have the laterally, the first rib and the first costal cartilage. So you can see that right there. Now the inferior thoracic aperture or thoracic outlet, it's wider than the superior thoracic aperture, and it's this right there. It forms the floor of the thoracic cavity. Its plane slopes posteriorly and inferiorly. And the structures running between the thorax and abdomen will pierce the diaphragm and pass posterior to it. So as you can see here, I'm gonna attempt to now draw it. So this is that outlet right there. You can see here, this is where some of the structures are piercing the diaphragm. And so the boundaries from posterior to anterior, let me try and go like this. Posteriorly, you're going to have the body of T12, which is this one right here. Inferior border of the 12 rib, which is this one right here. This one's right here. The tip of the 11th rib, which are these ones right here. The inferior borders of the 10th to 7th costal cartilages. So now if I go like this, you can see the costal cartilages right there. And also the sternal joint, which is right here, the joint, that's the xiphoid process, what I'm pointing at right now. And the infrasternal subcostal angle, which is located at inferior end of the sternum between right and left costal margins. So now let's go over the ribs. First of all, we got this classification of ribs where we have the true ribs. These true ribs, it's ribs 1 through 7, and these articulate anteriorly with their sternum, as you can observe right here, via their costal cartilages, right? Now we also have what we call the false ribs. It's not because they're not real tissue, but it's because their costal cartilage do not articulate anteriorly with the sternum as you can observe right here. And these are ribs 8 through 12. Now, specifically, ribs 8 through 10, which are these ones right here, this is 8, 9, and 10. These ones, their costal cartilage will articulate with the costal cartilage of the rib immediately above to form the costal margin, as you can see right here, right? And also we got ribs 11 and 12. I'm gonna try and show them to you right now. So this is 11th and this is 12. These two have no anterior connection with other ribs or the sternum, as you can observe right here. There's no costal cartilage for them. So these are also referred to as the floating ribs. Also, if you notice right here, we have ribs 3 to 9 that conform a common pattern, right? For example, this is rib number 3, 4, 5, right? So these are known as the typical ribs. But we also have a few atypical ribs. These are the first two and the last three ribs because they deviate somehow from the common pattern of the typical ribs. So this is rib number 1 and 2. And as you observe earlier, this is 11 and 12 and also 10th. Right? These are deviating somehow from that common pattern. Now, these typical ribs, for example, the ones we're observing here is 5 and 6. They have different parts, including a head, neck, a tubercle, and a shaft. So if you observe right here, the area that is posterior, the posterior end of the rib, it's where we have the head. This one has two articular facets separated by a crest. And these articular facets articulate with the costal facets on the body of the thoracic vertebra and the body of the vertebra immediately above, as you can observe right here. Also, the crest is going to be connected to the corresponding intervertebral disc by an intra-articular ligament. In the neck, I'm going to try to actually draw some for you. So this is where the head would be, right there. The neck, it's immediately next to it. So the neck is slightly constricted. It's a constricted part located lateral to the head. And then the tubercle is going to be posteriorly directed, bony eminence between the neck and the shaft, like right there. And then the shaft is this thin, flat, curved part of the rib with an internal and external surfaces. So again, as you can see, these are going to be the facets for articulation with the vertebrae. Right next to it is going to be the head of the rib. The neck, it's also right here on this area. And this right here is where it's going to be the articular facet. I'm going to try and mark it down over there. Also, this is what we call the angle of the rib. And then this, internally, there's going to be a costal groove on that rib, right? And then, like I said earlier, that's the shaft right there. And at the very end, this is where we have the junction with the costal cartilage right there. These are going to be your costal cartilage. And you have to imagine that this is where you will have the sternum. So now, as for the atypical ribs, remember that I said earlier that the first rib is one of those atypical ones. So here you're looking at rib number 1, and this usually is the shortest rib. Sometimes it's the 12th rib, but in this case, we're showing the first. Notice that it has a flattened surface from above downward, as you can see. And it has a superior and inferior surfaces instead of external and internal surfaces. The head also has a single articular facet. So I'm going to point out at the head right now so you can see it. So this is it right there. And it articulates only with the body of T1 right there. The superior surface has two shallow grooves on this area right here. one for the subclavian vein and one for the subclavian artery, which is going to be posterior. And it also has two grooves that are separated medially by the scalene tubercle, and it marks the insertion of the anterior scalene muscle. Another atypical rib is the second rib, which you can observe right here in blue. This also has a head, neck, and tubercle that conform to a common pattern. Nevertheless, this is twice as long as the first rib. As you can observe right here, this is the first rib. And the orientation of its surfaces is intermediate between that of the first rib and the typical ribs. Also, one surface faces outward, and the other surface faces inward and downward. And the outer surface has a tuberosity that marks the attachment of the serratus anterior muscle, as you can see right there. Now, the 10th rib has a single articular facet on its head, which articulates only with the body of T10, otherwise conforms to like a normal regular pattern like the other ribs. Now, as we mentioned earlier, 11th and 12th ribs, those are definitely atypical. Here's the 11th rib. This one will have a single articular facet on their heads, just like number 12. And it articulates only with the bodies of T11 and T12 respectively. So here's 11 and here's 12. And they have no tubercles, so they do not articulate with the transverse process of T11 and T12.